Well, by this time tomorrow night, you will have consumed your Thanksgiving dinner. Half of you will have experienced 12 football games. The other half will have been to Black Friday sales. And at least 3 million fans, non-fans, will have yelled out, "Enough is enough." Shortly after moving to Tempe, Josie found us a piece of property to lease in South Tempe. We didn't know of the day we signed, but living next door to the west of us was a beautiful horse, 3-year-old, and they called her Samantha. Well, they really called her Sam for short. And I hooked with this horse. I really enjoyed just going out and feeding her a little grass and on occasion some apple. Well, one day I was in the backyard and we had guests over for the 4th of July. And suddenly I heard this extreme noise. The noise was so loud, it sounded like someone had driven their car through the garage door. But as I raced toward that section of the house, I looked over into the backyard of the neighbors and I saw Samantha standing there and her water trough was overturned and she was beating on the side of that water trough to get my attention. So I raced around the neighbor's house, found the back gate unlocked and went in and righted the trough and began to fill it with water. And Samantha just stood there watching me until it had reached a certain level, and then she began to drink. And she drank, and she drank, and she drank. I filled the trough, put the hose back where it belonged, and went back home. But as I stayed on the patio, I kept hearing her drink. And then this thought came to me, what if somehow she doesn't know when to stop drinking? She gets the cramps, lays down and dies. What do I say to the neighbors? So I ran into the house. I called some people in our church that owned horses. And I shared with them the story I just shared with you. And the result on the other end was the lady began to laugh. And she said, "Pastor, that horse has more sense than people. That horse knows when to stop drinking. When she's had enough, she won't drink anymore." When is enough enough? You remember the critics in John D. Rockefeller's day asked him, "How much is enough? How much money do you need, Rockefeller?" And you remember he said, "Just a little bit more." You will recall that Jesus asked a similar question when a young executive came to see him. That young man asked him, "Rabbi, how do I get eternal life?" And Scripture makes it clear that Jesus knew that young man's heart. He knew that he had a lust for possessions. And so he looked him in the eye and he said to him, "You need to go and sell everything that you have, give it to the poor, and follow me." And Scripture tells us that that young man turned sorrowfully away. Elsewhere in Scripture, you remember that Jesus taught our life does not consist in the abundance of our possessions. Let's be candid tonight and admit that the world gives us another message. And that message is that you need a bigger house, you need a different car, you need a larger portfolio. But isn't it possible that enough may not be enough? Most of us sitting here tonight grew up on a song that we sang at camp, "What the World Needs Now is Love, Sweet Love." There was a similar song that was developed by the Coke division. But long before "Love, Sweet Love" and the Coke theme song, Jesus said to us, "Love your neighbor as you love yourself. He said the greatest commandment is to love your God with all your heart, your soul, and your mind, and love your neighbor as you love yourself. Now, most of us think of our neighbors as the people who live on either side of us, or across the street from us, or behind us. But the reality of the culture in which you and I live tonight is that our neighbors also include our family, our extended family, as well as our friends. I was on a flight from Phoenix to Denver, and when I reached the row where my seat was, a gentleman was already in that row, and he was on the window. I was on the aisle. There was a seat that separated the two of us. Most people who fly out of Phoenix fly out in cutoffs and flip-flops. This guy was dressed to the nines. I mean, you could tell that that suit was really expensive. Everything blended together. So to get the conversation going, I said to him, "Are you going into Denver for pleasure or for business?" "Ah," he said, "it's pleasure." He'd already shared with me the fact that he lived in Mesa, but he was going into Denver for his 50th wedding anniversary. "Ah," I said, "the bride has gone ahead and she's doing all the party prep." He said, "No, the bride lives in Denver." I said, "As a marriage counselor, you've got my attention. Help me understand how that works. She lives in Denver and you live in Mesa." He said, "Well, it's a long story." I said, "We're 79 minutes from the gate in Denver. I'm not going anywhere." And he began to share how that they'd met in college, fell in love, graduated, started a business together, watched it grow, and then the children came along. And he said, we were inseparable. We didn't do anything without the other person being with us. He said, finally, the kids grew up, went through college, got married. And he said, we just became closer and closer and closer. He said, the only time we were apart was when she went every week with her foursome out to play golf. And he said, I had my foursome. But we liked it that way because it gave us stories to tell one another when we got home. But he said, I began to notice something was happening to her. She wasn't remembering things as well as she used to. And he said, one day, a couple of her friends got on the phone with me and suggested that it was time that I got her some real help. The doctors, by this time, he said, had sat me down and explained to me what was going on. He said, I did my best to leave her at home. But he said, I knew I wasn't adequate for the challenge. So he said, I began to scour all across the U.S. And he said, I finally found a center in Denver that I believe would be able to meet her needs. And he said, she's been there now for 3 years. And he said, once a month, I fly to Denver and I spend a few days with her. But he said, tonight, the staff there at the center, they're putting on this tremendous meal. They've even ordered an anniversary cake that we'll cut. And they're bringing in a band, and we're going to go out on the dance floor and we're going to dance together. And then he stopped, sort of shook his head, and he said, but the sad thing is that at least 20 times tonight, she'll ask me who I am. What's your name? Do you live here in the center too? And he said, we'll go and cut the cake, and then we'll go dance. And then around 10 o'clock, she'll get tired, and he said, I'll walk her down the hall to her little apartment, and I'll go back to my hotel. I reached across the seat between us and put my hand on his arm, and I said to him, why do you do this? Why do you go see someone that doesn't have any memory of who you are at all, can't recall your name, doesn't recall the children, nothing? Why do you do this month after month? And he looked at me, Jeff, with a disgusted look on his face, and he said, you of all people shouldn't be asking me that question. You're a marriage counselor. You should know the answer to that. I said, humor me. He said, she is my best friend. And I would never think of abandoning her or leaving her alone. One is enough, not enough, when it comes to love. Forgiveness is another one of those not enoughs. If you're like I am, on occasion you go shopping and you go into some of these upscale, finesse kind of stores. They're the kind that, you know, they have the little sign hanging above the cash register that says, if you break it, you bought it. I get out of those places as quickly as I can. But there's another maxim in the marketplace that most of us are familiar with. And it basically says, if you owe, you pay. Jesus, you remember, was confronted by his disciples one day, and they asked him, how often are we to forgive somebody? If someone offends us, if someone owes us money and they refuse to pay, how often do we forgive them? Till seven times, Peter suggested. You remember in Matthew 18, Jesus begins to unfold a story, and I want to tell you that story in my own words tonight. Jesus told about a man who was the president and founder and CEO of a major company. It was a software company, and he had showrooms and offices that stretched from Jerusalem to Rome. They'd had banner years, but the bottom line always remained pretty static. So he brought in his auditors, and he laid everything out in front of them. They spent weeks, and finally they came back to him, and they said, you have a problem. The problem is you have a vice president who's embezzling from you. That's why the bottom line never grows. So he called in all of his vice presidents, all of his management team, sat them down in a large conference room, and he began to unveil what the auditors had said. The vice president, who was guilty of embezzling, sat there and he realized that he'd now been caught. He thought at first, well, maybe I can bluff this thing through. Maybe I can just stand and deny it and point the finger at somebody else. But the longer the CEO talked, the more convicted the embezzler became. And finally the thought hit him, what if I throw myself on his mercy? What if I go and admit what I've done, but ask him to forgive me, ask him to give me more time to repay the debt? And that's what he chose to do. Well, the other vice presidents sitting around the table were looking at their sandals. They couldn't believe this guy. They were saying to themselves, look at him, mister. What in the world are you doing groveling? For by this time, he'd gotten up and he'd moved to the chair where the CEO was. And he'd begun to beg for mercy. But the other vice president sitting there saying, look, man, you can't do this. The old man isn't that stupid. He isn't going to buy your crocodile tears. You've done the crime, now you can pay the time. As he knelt there, crying for mercy, the vice presidents looked up to see the CEO reach down and touch the embezzler on the shoulder and stood him up, put his arm, his hand out onto the embezzler's shoulder, and he said to him, I forgive you. And not only do I forgive you, but I'm also going to assume your debt. I know that you don't have the ability to repay it, but I'm going to choose to repay your debt for you. Although you owe it, I'll pay it. Jesus made it clear that night that that is the gospel message. We sinned, God paid. Communion drives home that truth for us tonight. The cross became God's means of making that payment. Christ's broken body and shed blood reminds us that his grace is enough. Jesus paid it all. All to him I owe. Sin has left a crimson stain. Christ washed it all away. Well, love and forgiveness leads us to thanksgiving. The scripture tells us that there are two kinds of people at Thanksgiving. There are givers and there are takers. And according to 2 Corinthians chapter 9, verse 8, we are to be takers of his grace. You see, grace is what the embezzler discovered. Listen to verse 8. And God is able to make all grace abound to you, so that in all things at all times, having all that you have need of, you will abound in every good work. And then Paul goes on to remind us that that accepted grace into our hearts and into our lives leads us to be generous. Verse 11, Paul went on to write, you will be made rich in every way so that you can be generous on every occasion, and through us your generosity will result in thanksgiving to God. God's grace appropriated into our lives and into our lifestyles allows us to become generous in every dimension of our life. One of my favorite books was written by Randy Pausch, who was a professor at Carnegie Mellon University. Randy shares with his student in the last lecture, which became his book, The Joy of Life. He talked to them about honesty and integrity and gratitude. He also shared with them the fact that he was dying of cancer. In fact, he had just a very few months left. And toward the end of his lecture, he talked to those 400 students, plus those in the overflow room listening by video, on what life meant to him. And he began to talk about his children, Dylan, age 6, Logan, age 3, Chloe, 18 months old. And then he revealed his love and gratitude for his wife by sharing a wonderful moment. He wrote in his book, near the end of the lecture, as I reviewed the lessons I'd learned in my life, I mentioned how vital it is to focus on other people, not just yourself. Looking off stage, he said, I asked, do we have a concrete example of focusing on somebody else over there? Could we bring it out? And then he shares how that friends rolled out this huge table with a huge birthday cake with one candle up in the middle of it. And he explained to the students that yesterday was his wife's birthday, but because of this lecture, he hadn't had time to do it right. And he wondered if they would join him in singing to her. The audience broke into applause and someone began to sing, happy birthday to you, happy birthday to you. And then he realized they didn't know her name, so he called out, her name is Jay. Happy birthday, dear Jay. happy birthday to you. He said, as I stood there for the first time, he said, I looked down on the front row where she was sitting. She was wiping tears from her eyes. And she was sitting there smiling with a surprised look on her face. So lovely, bashful, beautiful, pleased, and overwhelmed. What a classy way of saying, I'm thankful for you. I'm thankful for you. So tomorrow, as you gather around the Thanksgiving table, as you interact with family and friends, choose someone that you love. Someone who has stood with you through thick and thin, and tell them, I'm thankful for you. Will you join me in saying those words? I'm thankful for you. Once again, I'm thankful for you. Let's begin that tonight. Let's practice that tonight as we prepare for communion. Express to God, I'm thankful for you, God. I'm thankful for your love, your grace, your forgiveness. I'm thankful for Thanksgiving. Bow your heads, please, for prayer. Father, we give you the praise tonight because you're a God who's worthy of our praise. You're worthy of our thanksgiving. And we are reminded once again this evening of the freedoms that we have in this great country of ours, to be able to experience all that you have given to us. And we recognize tonight that every gift comes down from you. And so we praise you tonight. And all of this we pray in the name of the one who taught us to pray, our Father who art in heaven. Hallowed be thy name, thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. Amen.